Hi everyone. Today in this video, we are going to discuss about phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Phosphodiesterase inhibitors can be used in the various conditions, and these drugs are going to inhibit the metabolism of the phosphodiesterase enzyme. Thereby, they can increase the cyclic AMP or cyclic GMP levels. For example, these drugs can act on the heart as cardiotonics. They increase the force of contraction of the heart. Otherwise, they can act on the lungs to produce a bronchodilation. Therefore, these drugs are useful in the treatment of asthma as well as COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. And these drugs can also act on the blood vessels to increase the vasodilation, as well as they can also act on the platelets to decrease the platelet aggregation. In this way, phosphodiesterase inhibitors are having the wider therapeutic role. And today in this video, we will see the different types of phosphodiesterase inhibitors and how they are clinically used. The first one is a phosphodiesterase type 3 inhibitors. We have drugs which are ending with the suffix "-rinone". Here two drugs we have, amrinone as well as milrinone. And here, these two drugs are having a common structure like this, and we can observe this structure is having a pyridine ring which is attached by a single bond. So this is a bipyridine ring system with a ketone. So this is a bipyridinones. So from this we can derive the suffix "-rinone". Rinone indicates they are the phosphodiesterase type 3 inhibitors. Two drugs we have, amrinone as well as milrinone. So first one is the amrinone. You can observe in this structure, this is a bipyridinone with an amine group. So this amine is indicated within the name as the prefix "-m". So, amrinone is a amine-containing bipyridinone. Similarly, second one is the milrinone. Milrinone is having a nitrile group at this position. So, this is a nitrile-containing bipyridinone. And these two drugs are acting like cardiotonics. Compared with the amrinone, milrinone is 20 to 30 times more active in ionotropic activity. So, these two drugs are the ionotropic agents, particularly used in the treatment of congestive heart failure. So within the cardiac muscle, the cyclic AMP is going to play an important role. The cyclic AMP levels within the cardiac muscle can be controlled by the sympathetic system. Sympathetic system can act through the beta 1 receptors, which are going to increase the cyclic AMP. And whenever the cyclic AMP levels increases, the force of contraction of the heart increases. How it happens? Cyclic AMP can stimulate one group of the enzymes, protein kinase A. These enzymes are the phosphorylating enzymes, and they are responsible for the opening of the calcium channel. So calcium can enter into the cardiac muscle, and whenever calcium levels are going to be increased, it can be stored into the internal calcium stores. And whenever an impulse reaches to the cardiac muscle, it can produce a sudden release of the calcium, which produce a increased force of contraction. So the raised levels of the calcium within the cardiac muscle produce a contraction, and because of the excessive release of the calcium, it increases the force of contraction of the heart. In this way, cyclic AMP can increase the force of contraction of the heart, which is very important in the treatment of congestive heart failure. But this cyclic AMP action is going to be terminated by its metabolism to the AMP by one of the enzymes, phosphodiesterase type 3 enzymes, which are selective for the cardiac muscle. Now, these drugs like amrinone and milrinone, which are having the suffix "-rinone", can inhibit this phosphodiesterase type 3 enzyme within the cardiac muscle. Thereby, they can inhibit the metabolism of the cyclic AMP. In this way, these two drugs can increase the cyclic AMP levels within the cardiac muscle, which increase the force of contraction. That's why these drugs are used as ionotropic agents in the treatment of congestive heart failure. Second type of phosphodiesterase type 3 inhibitor is the dipyridamole. You can see that the structure is made up of two pyridine rings. This dipyridamole is having the multiple mechanisms of actions. It can inhibit the adenosine uptake. Adenosine is one of the important mediator which is responsible for the platelet aggregation. So it can inhibit the adenosine uptake, thereby adenosine related activities can be inhibited. And dipyridamole can directly inhibit the phosphodiesterase type 3 enzyme, thereby it can increase the cyclic AMP levels as well as cyclic GMP levels. And because of these raised cyclic AMP and cyclic GMP levels, it can produce a vasodilatation as well as inhibition of the platelet aggregation. And this drug can also increase the prostacyclin activity. Prostacyclin can decrease the platelet aggregation by producing the vasodilatation. So, in this way, dipyridamole can act as an antiplatelet agent by multiple mechanisms of actions. Similarly, another drug is the cilostazol. Cilostazol having the structure like this. And just like the diphenhydramine, xylazol can also produce two actions. It can increase the vasodilatation by acting on the vascular smooth muscle, as well as it can act on the platelets to inhibit the platelet aggregation. So xylazol is a vasodilator as well as an antiplatelet agent. So within the platelets, the aggregation of the platelets is mediated by calcium. So if you have the mediators like the thrombin, ADP, as well as thromboxane A2, all these mediators are acting like stimuli for platelet aggregation. They can increase the intracellular calcium levels within the platelets. And when the calcium is going to be increased, it results in the platelet aggregation. In this way, the mediators like the ADP, thromboxane A2, thrombin, all these can increase the platelet aggregation. But at the same time, cyclic AMP can act oppositely. The cyclic AMP can activate the protein kinase A enzymes, and these are the phosphorylating enzymes which will convert the VASP, vasodilator stimulated phosphoproteins. This VASP is going to be converted into VASP phosphorylated form, which becomes inactive. This results in the decreased the glycoprotein 2B by 3A receptor expressions. Thrombin can act on this glycoprotein 2B by 3A receptors, which produce a platelet aggregation. So when these receptors are less expressed, the platelet aggregation can be controlled. In this way, cyclic AMP can decrease the platelet aggregation by activation of the protein kinase A. But here again, cyclic AMP is going to be metabolized to AMP by the enzyme phosphodiesterase type 3 enzyme. This enzyme can be blocked by xylazol. In this way, xylazol can inhibit the platelet aggregation and it can act as an antiplatelet agent. Next is the drugs acting on the phosphodiesterase type 4, PDE4 inhibitor. So we have one of the drug, that is the roliprom. Roliprom is having the structure like this. So in this structure, we can observe one of the heterocyclic ring systems. So roliprom is having the pyrrolidine 2-1 ring system. And this drug acts like an antidepressant. Similarly, other phosphodiesterase type 4 inhibitors are having the suffix milast. So drugs like roflumilast and silomilast. Here the suffix milast is having the stem ast. So here what is the ast indicates? Ast indicates they are the anti-asthmatic agents. So asthma here having the AST, which is used as a suffix. So whenever a drug is having the suffix like AST, it indicates it is an anti-asthmatic agent or anti-allergic agent. So roflumilast and silomilast are the anti-asthmatic agents. And these two drugs can inhibit the phosphodiesterase type 4 enzyme, which is responsible for the conversion of cyclic AMP into AMP. When this enzyme is going to be blocked, the cyclic AMP levels are going to be increased, which results in the bronchodilation. So these two drugs are particularly acting on the bronchioles to produce a bronchodilation by increasing the cyclic AMP levels. That's why these drugs can be used in the treatment of asthma as well as COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So this is the structure of the roflumilast. Roflumilast is a benzamide derivative attached with the pyridine ring system. Similarly, this is the structure of the silomilast. Both of these drugs are anti-asthmatic agents. Fifth one is a phosphodiesterase type 5 inhibitors. These drugs are ending with the suffix -ephil. So we have the drugs like the sildenafil as well as tadalafil, vadenafil. All these are having the suffix -ephil. -ephil indicates they are the phosphodiesterase type 5 inhibitors. These drugs are going to produce the vasodilatation by inhibition of the phosphodiesterase type 5 enzyme, which increase the cyclic AMP levels, thereby produce a vasodilatation, as well as they also increase the cyclic GMP levels, which produce the relaxation of the corpus cavernosum, thereby they can produce the erection. In this way, phosphodiesterase type 5 inhibitors can be used in the erectile dysfunction as well as in the treatment of pulmonary hypertension. So within the corpus cavernosum, the nitric oxide is playing an important role. This nitric oxide can stimulate the gonyl cyclase system, GC. Whenever GC is going to be activated, it can convert the GTP into cyclic GMP. Cyclic GMP plays an important role within the corpus cavernosum. It can stimulate the one of the phosphorylating enzymes, protein kinase G. And whenever this protein kinase G are going to be activated, they are going to block the entry of the calcium channels. This is just quite opposite to the cardiac muscle, where the protein kinase A is going to stimulate the calcium entry, but here the protein kinase G is going to block the calcium entry. Now, because the calcium is not entering here, it produces the relaxation of the corpus cavernosum, which produces the erection. In this way, cyclic GMP can produce the erection by activation of the protein kinase G. But for release of the cyclic GMP, nitric oxide is required. Just like the other smooth muscles, here again the cyclic GMP can be metabolized into GMP by the enzyme phosphodiesterase type 5 enzyme. And this enzyme is going to be blocked by drugs like the sildenafil, tadalafil, vadenafil. All these drugs around the suffix are going to inhibit the phosphodiesterase type 5 enzyme. Thereby, they can increase the cyclic GMP levels. When our cyclic GMP levels increases, it produces a relaxation of the corpus cavernosum, resulting in the erection of the erectile tissue. That's why these drugs are useful in the treatment of erectile dysfunction as well as in the treatment of pulmonary hypertension. And finally, we have the non-selective phosphodiesterase inhibitors. We have natural products like the caffeine, theophylline, theobromine. All these are chemically belonging to the methyl xanthines. And they are non-selectively inhibiting the phosphodiesterase enzyme, thereby they can increase the cyclic AMP as well as cyclic GMP levels. So this is the structure of the caffeine. Caffeine is having the 137 trimethyl xanthine. And this is the structure of the theophylline. Theophylline is having the methyl groups at the first and third positions. So it is a 13 dimethyl xanthine. And third one is a theobromine. Theobromine is having the methyl groups at the third and seventh position. Now, these methyl xanthines are mainly acting by two mechanisms. They are going to inhibit the phosphodiesterase enzyme, thereby they can increase the cyclic AMP as well as cyclic GMP levels. But at the same time, they can also antagonize the adenosine receptors, adenosine 1 or adenosine 2 receptors, thereby they can inhibit the adenosine-mediated actions. Adenosine can produce a platelet aggregation as well as bronchoconstriction, which is blocked by methyl xanthines. In this way, methyl xanthines can act as bronchodilators, vasodilators, as well as antiplatelet agents. But one of the limitations is they are having the narrow therapeutic window. Theophylline is particularly used as an anti-asthmatic agent because it produces a bronchodilation, but it is having a narrow therapeutic window. So whatever the gap between the therapeutic and lethal dose is very less. And apart from this, theophylline can also inhibit the metabolic enzymes like the cytochrome P450 enzymes, which results in the so many drug interactions. That's why methyl xanthines are nowadays having the less clinical use because we have better alternative drugs. So that's about the phosphodiesterase inhibitors. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel, share this video with your friends, post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.